Hello and welcome back to 365 Days with mxmtoon. I'm Maia, a singer, songwriter, video maker, Oakland native, and a weird weather watcher. I'm also a huge fan of history. I love untold stories, gross facts, hidden secrets, and anything weird, dark, and funky from the past. Each day, I'm going to share one of my favorite deep cuts with you, so let's take a look at today's story.
It's 365 with mxmtoon. New facts every day, so don't leave too soon. I'm gonna teach you stuff, no, it won't be tough. Gonna go a year till you've had enough. It's 365.
On this day in 2018, a Sahara Desert sandstorm turned the snow in Sochi, Russia, orange. We all noticed you're clear of yellow snow, but orange? Now that's pretty strange. Let's take a look back on what caused this bizarre weather event. In southern Russia, the historic city of Sochi sits along the Black Sea. It's one of the only cities in Russia that experiences hot summers and snowy winters, making it a popular vacation spot in Eastern Europe. Even while the sun shines on its seaside beaches, the mountainous ski slopes are permanently covered in snow. If the resort town Sochi rings a bell, that might be because it was the location of the 22nd Olympic Winter Games and the 11th Winter Paralympics in 2014. But when the people of Sochi hit the slopes March 23rd, 2018, the scene that awaited them looked more like the surface of Mars than the pillowy clouds of snow that they were used to. When skiers scooped the snow in their hands, they found clay-colored grains of sand dusting the familiar snow. But this unbelievably strange weather event didn't stop them from strapping on their skis and continuing on as though it were a normal day. Even though the slopes at the popular ski resort, Rosa Hooter, were orange, it was still perfectly safe to ski. Here's how it happened. Clay and sand from the Saharan and Arabian deserts got swept up into a polar jet stream, a fast-flowing air current at a low altitude. Sometimes these jet streams seem to have a mind of their own, and this one snuck uncommonly far south to Libya. In the week leading up to the appearance of orange snow in Sochi, there was a lot of thunder, rain, and wind circulating around Italy, the Balkans, and Eastern Europe. So you could say that this weather created the perfect storm of conditions to allow the polar jet stream to whip up clay and snow from Africa and carry it all the way to Russia. It's actually not that uncommon for Saharan dust to get pulled through the atmosphere to Europe. In the UK, there are usually a few days each year when you might notice a slight dustiness in the air. But if a small layer of reddish dust lands on top of cars or in a grassy field, it won't be that noticeable. But on top of snow, now that is another story. And that's why this was such an exciting natural phenomena. While the orange, Martian-looking ski slopes of Sochi were quite harmless, sometimes reddish hues in the air can be a cause for alarm. In October 2017, Hurricane Ophelia unearthed some dust from the Sahara Desert, causing the sky and the sun to look red in parts of England and Wales. Sadly, the sinister apocalyptic sun wasn't as harmless in this case. During this time, there were forest fires across Spain and Portugal, which cast pollutant debris through the atmosphere. These horrific wildfires raged on for 5 days, resulting in at least 49 deaths. Even with over 400 firefighters present trying to tame the flames, the Portuguese government still had to enlist the help from neighboring countries. This contributed to the scary-looking red sun in the UK, but in other places, the effects were even more like a horror movie. The strong winds of Hurricane Ophelia swept up the soot from the fires, mixing it with the Saharan dust. In Estonia, the soot caused black rain, which does not sound nearly as fun as skiing on orange snow. Personally, coming from California, a state that's really well known for wildfires, you get really used to having a fire season. We don't actually call it fall, we just call it fire season because our temperatures and what you expect every single time fall comes around annually is just for the entire state to catch on flames. It's really scary. I used to go to school wearing a mask every single day, much similar to the ones that we wear nowadays during a global pandemic, and I wore it to protect my lungs because the air was so filled with ash and dust that you shouldn't breathe without wearing one. I even had my train catch on fire a bunch of times because the air was so dry that anything would catch on fire. It's really scary, and we need to do something about it. During the global climate crisis, strange weather usually has some more frightening undertones, warning us of our impending doom. I'll say it again, black rain. But the orange snow in Sochi offered a fun reprieve from the constant reminders of our mortality. Anyway, do something today to protect the environment. Bring a reusable bag to the store or make that extra effort to recycle your LaCroix can. As fun as Martian skiing sounds, I promise you, it is not fun to walk around a world of ash. Now let's talk about music. On this day in 1961, Elvis Presley recorded the iconic song Can't Help Falling in Love in Hollywood, California. Written by Hugo Peretti and Luigi Creator and George David Weiss, the melody is derived from a French love song composed in 1784. The Elvis single appeared on his album Blue Hawaii, which was the soundtrack to his romantic comedy film of the same name. In the 60 years since the song's release, the ballad has been covered again and again. Kina Grannis, a singer-songwriter and YouTuber, covered Can't Help Falling in Love, and her rendition appeared in a pivotal moment in the 2018 film Crazy Rich Asians. Other artists like Ingrid Michaelson, 21 Pilots, and even Bob Dylan have put their own spin on the classic. There's something timeless about this hit that makes me think that we'll see more and more beautiful covers from years way farther than this one. And now for our final segment of the day, I'm going to go into my own photo archives to see what I was up to on a March 23rd in my life. On March 23rd, 2018, I took my best friend Anna to go get a tattoo. She, I think it was her first tattoo. She decided to put it on her ribcage. And I believe they chose like a, I think it was something for their granddad. So it was really exciting, and I wasn't old enough to get a tattoo yet, so I watched her go through the whole process, and they both, like, we just love tattoos, and it's something we talk about constantly, so it was really exciting to be able to go with her and watch them get their first tattoo. And I, since then, have collected my fair amount of tattoos. I got one, I think, a couple weeks ago of some ginkgo leaves, and I have, okay, let me count, one on my ribcage, one big one on my arm, another one on my arm there, and another one on my arm. I have three on my left arm, two on my right arm, and a ribcage tattoo. So I'm slowly building my collection. One day I'll get there. Thanks for going back in time with me, and remember to subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts, and you can come back tomorrow for more stories from yesteryear.
It's 365 with MXMTune. New facts every day, so don't leave too soon. I'm gonna teach you stuff, no, it won't be tough. Gonna go a year till you've had enough. It's 365.